Hey, I'm Jennifer Amundsen. I'm the Assistant Executive Director of COCA. Thank you for joining us today for COCA Academy. And it's great to see everyone this morning. I'm going to kick it over to Hattie Johnson, Region 1 Director, who's going to introduce our speaker today.
Perfect. Well, welcome everyone. Good morning or good afternoon, wherever you may be. I am happy that you're all here today for the second day of the COCA Academy. For those of you who joined us last time on September 30th for day one, which was everything about virtual fundraising events, today is really all about peer-to-peer fundraising. So again, what we realized was that the topics that we wanted to cover in this year's COCA Academy are the hot topics right now. And peer-to-peer fundraising, what better people to turn to than our peers who are already invested in our mission, have an affinity to our camps. And so I want to welcome Marcy Maxwell from Charity Dynamics, who is going to join us today and really talk about everything peer-to-peer, best practices, you know, things to consider when you're thinking about a peer-to-peer campaign. And so Marcy is really an expert in this area, does this every day. And so we're really happy that she's here, that she's willing to share her expertise with all of us. Just a few things to note, all of the COCA Academy sessions are being recorded. So you can go back to the virtual platform and check those out at a later time or share them with other people at your camp that maybe weren't able to sit in today. And then the third, so there's a couple more sessions today. There's one at 3 p.m. Eastern time, which is going to be three COCA camps talking about the success of their peer-to-peer fundraising campaigns that they recently did. Again, they're not going to just tell you how great they did and we're just going to clap our hands and say, yay. They're going to actually tell you what they learned. They're going to give you pro tips so that you can go back and implement the information that you learned from Marcy today. Also to walk away and don't reinvent the wheel. There's other camps that have already done this. So take away, learn from them, learn what they did right, what they did wrong, their challenges, their successes, all of that great things. And then tonight at 8 p.m. Eastern time, we have someone from One Cause coming on to talk about their platform, which is a great platform that can really help you implement all of this and actually host a peer-to-peer campaign at your camp. So we're excited for today, all the great information that is going to be shared. And then our next live session for the COCA Academy will be on November 12th. And that's really going to be, we have someone from CCS that is coming to do a presentation on how to engage with your donors now. It's still that awkward time. We're still trying to figure out when the right time to ask is. How do you ask? How do you make that or start that that conversation with donors? So Kate Villa and her teammates are going to be presenting on the 12th, and then we're going to end with a fundraising town hall. So I hope to see you throughout the rest of the COCA Academy. But right now I'm going to turn it over to Marcy. So Marcy, if you want to share your screen and give an intro, that would be great.
Great. Thank you so much, Hattie. Excited to be here with all of you as we talk about making the most of peer-to-peer fundraising. So I'll just dive right in just to give you a little bit of introduction of who I am. As Hattie mentioned, I work for a company called Charity Dynamics, which I'll tell you about in just a second. But I've been in the nonprofit space for over 15 years. I spent a lot of space, frankly, in a similar space to what you do here at the Children's Oncology Camping Association. I spent 11 years at St. Jude Children's Research Hospital in fundraising, and then 5 years at Make-A-Wish America. So I think we all have the heart for a lot of the same things and the great missions that y'all do. So now that I'm at Charity Dynamics, I work with organizations of all sizes on their peer-to-peer fundraising campaigns. So everything from their big picture strategy to their e-communication to their digital marketing, their web design. We've been doing a lot with transitioning events to virtual events, people who are so used to having them in person. And what does that look like now? As Jennifer and I were talking, I am a Louisiana girl at heart, but I now reside in Memphis, Tennessee. So a little bit about me. About Charity Dynamics quickly, and the company that I work for, we are a full service digital marketing and fundraising agency solely focused on nonprofits. So serving nonprofits is all that we do. And so, as I said, it's everything from fundraising strategy to user experience on your website. We have participant support. We have a proprietary fundraising app that we have developed that plugs in with a lot of systems, a lot of platforms, to where your participants, your peer-to-peer participants can take their fundraising on the go. And again, as I said, we work with more than 150 nonprofit organizations, and that is all we do. That's all we serve. So excited to just talk a little bit more. As I said, I've been doing peer-to-peer for a long time, and a lot of the best practices have quite frankly stayed the same. They're just kind of in a new media and with new audiences. So what are our objectives for today? We're gonna do a level set of just what is peer-to-peer fundraising. I'd love to talk about how you can be a successful peer-to-peer fundraiser, because frankly, you need to know how to do it before you try and go coach someone else on how to be a successful peer-to-peer fundraiser. So those are kind of be the three buckets we're going to talk through. I know Jennifer said there's questions, there's a chat box. If you have anything you want me to dig in deeper on, I know we'll have some time for that later on in the day. So let me just start with what is peer-to-peer fundraising. So there's a model that I've used through the years that I love. So when you think about traditional fundraising, so everything from direct response to individual giving to major donors, you know, that is a one-to-one relationship. It is relying on the organization to make a direct ask to a potential donor. Where peer-to-peer comes in is when you actually take that another level and you at the organization asks the fundraiser to make the ask. So what is great is that it starts to get exponential, and oftentimes peer-to-peer fundraising brings new people into your organization and introduces them to what you're doing in a way that maybe you wouldn't have never found them on your own. And then when you take, whether it's an event-based campaign or a champion-based campaign, and you add in this other role of, you know, adding a, you ask a team captain to form a team and the team members ask people to donate. Again, that's really where there's this exponential power of peer-to-peer when you do that. And so that's where there's a little bit of the difference. You know, what is the power of peer-to-peer? You know, yes, it's going to raise funds for your mission, which is really important. It also acquires new donors. So new donors that maybe wouldn't have given before, except Hattie asked me to give and I'm going to give and learn more about your mission. And it can be a great way to build community awareness, again, spreading out to new people. It's a great way to really deepen those relationships with volunteers and with those champions, the advocates who are raising their hand and saying, I want to do more. I want to go above and beyond. It's a great platform to have available for them. It's a great way to expand your brand. Again, empowering a group of fundraisers. It can also be a really great platform for new corporate engagement. And frankly, it provides leadership opportunities. At every organization, you're always looking for those people who really step up. This is a great way to start to test the waters and provide that opportunity for people. I know I've seen through the years amazing peer-to-peer fundraisers who go on to be board members or leaders within your organization. And that can be a really, this can be a really powerful channel. So what type of peer-to-peer campaigns are there? I think for a long time, people only thought of peer-to-peer as your traditional run, walk, or ride. Try to say that fast. You get a little bit of a mouthful. And that is the most traditional form where you invite a participant to raise money as they participate in an actual physical event. Sometimes these events also require participants to fundraise, so they actually make a fundraising commitment. An event-based peer-to-peer is a really great way to engage new people because they are coming to your, oftentimes they're coming to your mission because the event excites them, and then they can learn more about you and be more inspired to fundraise. what has really been popping up is a couple other channels. And so one is milestone or tribute fundraising. So this is when somebody starts a peer-to-peer campaign in honor of their birthday or an anniversary. I've seen people do it in honor of a cancer anniversary or a survivor milestone. People do it in honor of their wedding in lieu of gifts or favors. They do a peer-to-peer campaign. We've also seen people that set this up in honor or memory of a loved one. So if a family member has passed and they've said, this is how we want to get back, they can set up a peer-to-peer campaign in that honor as well. We're also starting to see, this is a fancy term, ambassador fundraising. So this is when it's kind of a standalone peer-to-peer campaign, but it's when you're inviting really strong existing supporters to do a campaign for you. They may not necessarily be a major donor, but they have major networks that they can bring to the table. So it's a true one-off request. You know, whether it is, I've seen people do, you know, we're asked in honor of an anniversary. They're saying it's 50 years of our organization. We're looking for 50 people who can get 50 more people to donate $50. And suddenly you have this exponential effect of ambassador fundraising. I've also seen people tie this even to a fancy gala where they have people raise money as they participate and they get some honorarium at the event. And then corporate campaigns are also a great opportunity. So companies are looking more and more for how they can engage beyond just your typical employee giving. So having a customizable employee engagement experience that fits with their company culture and their vibe. What's great with companies is there's a built-in team dynamic already and communication channels that exist that you can then leverage to be a part of your peer-to-peer campaign. So those are just a couple of the options I wanted to suggest. I know I'm excited you're going to be hearing from some of your peers later on today who can also chime in with some of this. So you now you're thinking, okay, lots of different ideas, but where do I start? If I said to you today, all right, Tara, you're going to do a peer-to-peer campaign, you're going to go raise money, what does that look like? So, and we're seeing her face. So you really want to put yourself in your fundraiser's shoes. And where do you want to start? So first and foremost, you always want to set a goal, right? How much do you want to raise for this cause? Updating your personal goal on your personal page. So friends and family can help you achieve that goal. You know, studies show literally participants who set a fundraising goal raise 4 times more than those who don't. That sounds super intuitive. But again, you're putting pen to paper and saying, this is how much I want to raise, even if it's only $200. You know, you're still making that personal commitment that you want to do it. Starting small, not being afraid to make your own personal contribution doesn't have to be a lot, but you're kind of putting your money where your mouth is in some ways. And so asking a couple of friends to match your donation. Again, people who make that personal contribution to their goal raise 3.5 times more than those who don't. And really the other thing is sharing your why. You have a reason why you are doing this fundraiser. Is it honoring your own experience? Is it supporting a loved one? Making that personal page include your personal story. We so often hear people say, share your story. And I think people are hesitant sometimes. They're like, I don't have a story. I don't have a story that's that exciting. But the reality is we all do. We're all motivated to do this for a reason. And when you make that personal update, this is really the kicker. People who do that raise 9.5 times more than those who don't. What I love about these three things is, and we're going to get to this as we get into coaching, as you're working with a fundraiser, these are all very easy, simple steps that somebody can take that are coachable. Things that you can say, have you done this yet? Have you done this yet? Let's start here. So in terms of who do you ask, you know, I'll be honest, you know more people than you think you do. I always think it's helpful when you're starting a peer-to-peer campaign to literally put pen to paper or open up your, you know, the notes part of your iPhone or on your smartphone. But just start making that list of all of your possible connections, and you'll be surprised how quickly that list is going to grow. So everything from, you know, family and close friends to your business contacts, people that go to your church or worship group, your workout buddies. If you are a person who sends out holiday cards, that is a perfect list to go to. Your friends' parents, your parents' friends. There's so many different ways to start thinking about that. And what's really important is you never know which of these connections might also share a passion for the cause. So don't be bashful in asking. You know, think about yourself. I mean, do you ever look at somebody who asks you to donate to a cause that they love with judgment? No, you know, that's not what people are doing. So I think it's not being bashful and just being willing to put it out there. So you've got your list. You've set your goal, you've made your gift, you know, so how do you ask, right? I think it's important to remember that different people are going to respond in different ways and with different asks. So I always like to think about it in terms of a pyramid. So, you know, your base of your pyramid is often social media. That is where you can a lot of times have the greatest reach to push your fundraising page out. It might hit people who you have a little bit of a lower connection to, and so therefore they may just maybe a little bit of a lower donation, but there's more people to reach. That second base is emails and texts. It's people that you actually have their personal contact information. You have a closer connection. And then lastly, it's not being afraid to do letters and personal asks. Those are going to be reserved for, you know, that close inner circle. But again, if they're that close inner circle, they also know how important this cause is to you. So they're probably more likely to give you a little bit of a higher donation, even though it's a smaller group. So again, when you start with email and text, family, coworkers, close friends, always want to make it personal. Most platforms that you might use do offer pre-written templates to where you can just literally plug and play, you know, a name or a brief information. But it's great to add in your own note to share why you're fundraising. And then not being afraid of following up. So don't be afraid to send that quick reminder. I will say every single time I fundraise, I have two sisters. One is the first person to donate and one is the last. And I have to email her or text her the night before an event and say, seriously, you are the last person who has not donated. Can I count on you to make a donation? And she always will, but she probably wouldn't if I didn't send that reminder, right? Then you think about those close people using snail mail. So a personal handwritten note still goes a long way. They can still donate online. You just include your link to your fundraising page. They could mail in a check. You know, I always think about my grandparents are not online. And every time I fundraise, they're the only people that I don't ask, because I can't send an email. And so I had to realize I have to be able to send a note to give them a way to still contribute, because of course they want to support. And then again, picking up the phone. So similar to texting my sister, sometimes an email gets lost. So don't be afraid to follow up if there's somebody you know, again, mom, dad, best friend, mother-in-law, you know, whatever that is, to say, hey, can I still count on you for that contribution? And lastly, when it comes to social media, again, this is where I think this has grown so much in the peer-to-peer space in terms of how people rely on it. I think it'd be a great way to issue a challenge, you know, offering friends and family a reward. It could be a funny thank you video. It could be a poem, a song, for the next person who donates. I have seen one of the most successful campaigns I have seen was somebody who said, for everyone who donates X amount, I am going to find your celebrity doppelganger, so your celebrity lookalike, and I'm gonna post it on social media. And she raised like $1,500 in 3 days because everybody wanted to know who she thought their celebrity lookalike was. And then posting often. So I think what I often see is people are like, well, I already posted, but we all know how those news feeds are and things get lost. So post with some regularity. And a great way to do that is thanking your supporters. So whenever I do it, if I get a donation, you know, if Hattie was to donate to my page, I would say, thank you so much to Hattie Johnson. You're so amazing. for supporting me with a donation, who wants to be next? And then I would include my link. So it doesn't become just yet another ask over and over again, but it's a shout out, it's recognition, it's showing your gratitude. And a lot of times that inspires other people or reminds other people who are like, ooh, I need to do that. So now you might be thinking, okay, I know who to ask, how to ask, but really what do I say? And I think that is where you just need to keep it simple. You know, it's saying this cause is really important to me because, whether that is I've lost a family member to this disease, I've seen firsthand the impact of one of these camps. I feel strongly that no child should go without, a full day of meals. You know, whatever that is, this is why it's important to me. And then saying, this is why I've decided to do X to raise money. So I've decided to host my own event, commit to walking every day for 30 days, or participate in this cycling event to raise money. And will you help by doing X? Will you help by donating, by giving $35 for my 35-mile bike ride? Will you join my team? You know, it's simple. It's keeping it just, I think so often we don't know what to say. So if you can just say, this is, why is it important? What are you doing about it? And how can they help? Those three things are gonna keep it really, really tight, really crisp, and are gonna make you feel more comfortable as you're starting to ask. And so what else, right? So there's so many other things you can do. So going beyond the basics, asking in person can still be really easy and powerful. I know we are in a very weird time right now where maybe we're not seeing as many people in person, but those people that maybe we are, again, whether behind a mask or not, doesn't hurt to still continue to ask. I've always had luck when you can be specific. So using a birthday or a milestone to add a personal twist to your ask. So $42 in honor of your 42nd birthday, or $15 for your 15-year wedding anniversary, or $26.2 because I'm running a marathon. You know, finding things like that that make it a little bit of a hook that makes people go, oh, okay. One of the most successful ones I ever had was, I think it was my 11-year anniversary working at St. Jude. And so I pushed that out and all I asked was for $11, and the amount of people who saw that as an opportunity to, again, recognize and acknowledge me for my 11 years of service with a really simple donation. I was surprised how many people did that, and it was exciting. So rallying your friends together, again, this is a little bit challenging in our virtual world, but we all have learned the art of social distance happy hours, right? So gathering people together to watch a game, watch a show, and just collecting donations at the door can be a great way, especially when things go a little bit back to normal. And then taking your fundraising to work. So whether it's collaborating with your boss, the HR department, to host a drawing, or to get a front door parking spot once we're back in the office, or maybe in the virtual world that you're going to get pizza delivered to your house, or they're going to pay for your internet for a month, or whatever that is. You can find different ways to collaborate and say, what would motivate people in our company to donate to what we're doing? And then again, keeping that link handy. So if you are fundraising online, it's bookmarking it or saving it in your notes page of your phone, so that if somebody says, oh, tell me about what you're doing, you can very quickly click share and say, guess what? It's in your inbox right now. You can donate. You know, meeting your friends where you are. Most platforms allow you to connect your fundraising to a Facebook fundraiser. And so that is something that it's very automated on your Facebook page, where people can directly connect, and all those donations. It's basically a funnel. It funnels back over to your fundraising page. Be a great, I believe One Cause does it. Be a great question to ask them this evening. Doubling the power of your gifts. You know, if your employer or your donor's employers, do they match charitable contributions? I left off the link. I apologize. And then creating a fundraising video and challenge others to donate, whether it's to fight to end cancer or to fund more kids going to camp, and post it on social media. And then you can set a goal to just raise, how much can you raise in one day? And that creates a sense of urgency for people. So all of these are just tips and tricks that you as the personal fundraiser can do, but there are also things that you as the coach can share with your fundraisers who are saying, that's great. I have a big goal. I want to raise $10,000, but I don't know where to start, right? So it's important to know that it's your job to be the coach. And so why does that matter? I think sometimes when it comes to peer-to-peer, we assume that our fundraisers know that we need them to fundraise. They sometimes think of it as just an event and I'm going to attend the event, and they don't realize it's a fundraising event. Sometimes we assume that our fundraisers know how to fundraise and they don't. And sometimes we assume they know why. You know, we want to make sure that we're sharing tips and tricks, that we're showing the impact, and that we're letting them know why we need them to do this. And that is only going to come through coaching. So then you want to think about, who should you be coaching? So there's a couple, you know, thoughts out there about what makes a great fundraiser. So if you're thinking, okay, maybe I don't have time to talk to absolutely every single fundraiser, where do I start? So what makes a great fundraiser? So we already said one, setting a fundraising goal. That is something, again, when they sign up online, they have the ability to indicate with their registration. So it's information they're already giving you. Do they have a strong connection to your mission? This is a great, I would recommend, if you are setting up a fundraising platform, you can add questions during registration. This is a great question to ask of, what's your connection to our cause? And so that way you kind of start to know, and they're starting to indicate to you how strong that mission connection is. That just, again, it opens the door for that conversation, right? The more information you know, the better. Being a team captain, so if you do a team-based event, somebody who is raising their hand and saying, not only do I want to fundraise, but I want to lead a group of people to fundraise, that's a great indicator. People who sign up in advance. So no matter what you're doing with your event, people who sign up, you know, 3 months ahead of time to fundraise, they're going to be more successful. I think for a couple reasons. A, they're clearly excited about what you're doing. They have more time to fundraise, and their donors have more time to give. So that's where those reminders come really come in handy as well. Updating their personal page, sharing that story. If there are returning participants, so somebody who does it year over year, statistically raises more money. So getting people to return and participate and join your event or join your campaign year over year is really important. Making that self-donation, which I said, and sending emails, quite simply. All of these things, traditionally, you can see through your fundraising setup of your platform, right? And most of these things you can coach somebody to do. And why does that matter? Because, again, I've already started sharing some of these stats, but people who register and fundraise earlier raise more money. People who make a donation raise more money. Setting a goal, it's almost four times more. You know, people who are a team captain, 6.5 times more. Their personal page, 9 times more. Sending emails, almost 10 times more. And if they do all 6 of these things, they raise 2,258 times more, right? Than somebody who does none of them. So this is why all of these things, it's not set it and forget it, right? You want to be actively coaching these people to take these little micro actions that start to make a big impact, right? So you might be thinking, okay, Marcy, that's great, but I have 1,000 people participating in my event, right? Cross our fingers. You've got to prioritize. The reality is you probably can't work with absolutely every single person. So I like to bucket people, teams or fundraisers, into A, Bs, and Cs. You know, your A's are going to be the people, they're really active right now. You know, they're checking off all of those boxes that we just talked about, or they were a top fundraiser last year. These are the people you want to be in close contact with. These are your new BFFs. And the reality is, usually this ends up being about 20% of your participants and they're bringing in probably 80% of your money. So these are, this is like the key group that you focus on, right? Your Bs, those are the ones that maybe they're just getting started or they're checking off a couple of the boxes, but they need a little bit more encouragement, a little more help. Maybe they fundraised a little bit last year, but they have more potential. Again, those are ones you're still reaching out to with some regularity and kind of gauging how much more they have the ability to do. Maybe bump them up to team A or A team. And then lastly, there's your C team. So these are the people, a lot of times people call these your $0 fundraisers. These are out of 1,000 people showing, you know, participating in your event, you might have half of them that pay a registration fee and that's it, or they just show up, right? They show up and eat your apples and want a free t-shirt, right? Not to say that they are not important, they're supporting you, it's great, but those are not the ones where you should be spending your very precious time. You know, if somebody is still sitting at zero or even sitting at $25 and you've reached out a few times and they're not responding, you're getting nothing back, just try a couple times and then stop. Kind of bless and release. They'll still probably get some, you know, larger emails from you, and that's great. But in terms of where you should spend your prioritized, very limited time that we all have as fundraisers is on those people that really are going to bring in the majority of your fundraising dollars, right? So how should you be coaching? So I hear from a lot of people, they're like, well, I'm going to send emails. And while emails are great, emails are only one piece of the puzzle. So again, there's personal messages, there's phone calls, in-person meetings, especially with those high dollar fundraisers. And I should probably qualify that and say one-on-one meetings, right? Might not actually be in person right now, but a one-on-one Zoom call could be great. Text messages, social media shout outs, coaching emails, quick drop-in visits. All of these different channels are a great way to communicate. And so if you just sit behind one email a week or one email a month, you're not building a relationship. So I think that's what at the end of the day of how are you coaching, the goal is to build the relationship with somebody. And if you're just having a one-way conversation, it's not a relationship if they're not talking back. And so that's really a key way to do it. And especially if, you know, you have the ability to get people raising, you know, hundreds and thousands of dollars, you know, you start to think about those high dollar fundraisers as how would you treat somebody who donated $1,000 to your organization? And are you treating somebody who's fundraising $1,000 in the same manner? So let's think a little bit about a timeline. And so let's say you've got an event set. So let's say you're doing a race, right? You're doing a 5K race. How often should you be talking to your fundraisers? It's great to kind of build out a structure for yourself. So let's say somebody signs up 16 weeks out, 4 months. They've signed up really that next week. You want to call and welcome them and offer your support. That is something I think sometimes catches people off guard. They're like, wow, they really care that I'm signed up to do this event, but it sets that precedent that they are important and that their fundraising is important. You know, setting up that coffee lunch meeting, again, a virtual coffee, virtual lunch meeting, that one-on-one conversation. And really at that one-on-one conversation, that is to discuss their goals and to discuss their ideas for how they're going to hit that goal. And that conversation could look something as simple as, hey, Jennifer, I know last year, you know, your team raised $3,000. What goal do you have in mind this year? Do you think you could get to 5,000 or 4,000? So it doesn't have to be, you know, this really, you know, structured technical conversation. It just becomes, how much do you think you want to raise this year? And then they might say, you know, yes, we're really striving for 5, or they might say, you know, it's been a really tough year. I'm hoping we can just maybe get to 1500 this year. But then you know what they're intending to do. So even if it's a lower amount, having that conversation is great. And saying, how can we help you get there? What's your plan? What tools do you need? What support do you need? The more you have that upfront, it empowers them to kind of create that own plan and figure it out, but then they also know they have you as a resource. Calling in to offer web help, you know, I think that is something that is key. Sometimes people can't figure out something on a website and then they feel stupid and they don't want to ask. So if you just call proactively and say, hey, just want to check in. How are things going on the website? Do you need any quick tutorials? I can walk you through something. Super simple. And they might say, no, I got it, but I have these three other questions. Or they just say, no, I got it, I'm good. And you say, great, I'll check in with you again if you have any other questions. Sending that personal note when they hit a fundraising milestone. You know, oh my gosh, Tara, that's amazing. I saw you already crossed the $1,000 mark. This is so fantastic. Keep up the good work. Or better yet, if they're doing really well, say what's working for you. Because then, A, you get ideas to share with others and it makes them feel super special and important because they're like, wow, she like wants my ideas. This is awesome. Calling again to check in on the progress to the goal. If they're not doing well towards their goal, recalibrate and say, okay, you don't think you're gonna be able to get to 1500 this year? Why don't we shoot for 1000? Let's just adjust. Again, it's all about knowing where they're at, then making them feel like they're forced to hit a certain goal. And checking in again, sending that personal note again as they hit different goals, calling with final reminders, and then post event. If this is a physical in-person event, I always recommend blocking out time on your calendar to focus on calling those top fundraisers simply with a phone call, just to say, what did you think of the event? We loved having you there. Or I know I didn't get to visit with you very much, but I wanted, what was your favorite part of the day? Again, it's all about stewardship and that's starting to line them up to hopefully they're saying, here's everything I loved. You know, I'm definitely going to be back next year. Or actually, here's the things I didn't like. And then that's an invitation to invite them to maybe join a committee or participate in making that event better, right? Turn lemons into lemonade. So again, what do you talk about? You always want to go into a conversation with a purpose, right? If you're just picking up the phone and saying, hey, just checking in, they're probably like, I'm good, thanks. That's not a really great conversation, right? But calling and say, knowing, hey, I just heard this great fundraising tip from another fundraiser and it made me think of you. Or wanted to make sure we know about this challenge week that's coming up. We're going to have a challenge every day and some great prizes. I wanted to make sure it's on your calendar. Again, walking them through the tools, understanding their personal motivation, simply saying, tell me a little bit more about why you signed up to participate this year. Connecting them with a prior fundraiser can be a great thing as well, especially as your events grow, maybe beyond your bandwidth, to be able to say, you know what, I have another team captain I think would be really great for you to have a conversation with. Let me introduce you over email. If you're talking to them about how they can recruit more people to join, offering those steps, setting up that face-to-face time. You know, you want to go into every conversation and say, you know, what's my objective for this conversation? Is it, I want to make sure we get that phone call, or I want to make sure they feel comfortable with the online tools, whatever that is. If you go into it that way, it's going to set you up for such more of a productive conversation versus that one where they just said, yeah, I'm all good. Thanks for calling. Awkward hang up, right? Nobody likes that. So what else can you do? So I think, again, I think it's so much of this is about empowering your team captains. Again, everybody in the fundraising space, we all have limited manpower. So if you can start to leverage those champions, those fundraising leaders to know what their goals are, for them to really set the example for the group by following fundraising best practices, that they're checking in regularly with the progress to their goal and encouraging them to, again, model the way and coach and challenge and motivate their teams. You know, if I'm on a team and Hattie is my team captain, you know, Hattie is going to know more about what motivates me than maybe Jennifer, who works at the office that I've never met. So empowering that team captain to say, what would excite your team members? Do they all love your homemade chocolate chip cookies? Could you offer that to your top fundraiser? I mean, that seems so silly, but we all know what a motivator is. You know, is it, oh, you're going to buy the best bottle of wine on your trip to wherever and your top fundraiser gets that. different things are going to motivate different groups, and you make it super local, super personal within that group of 5, 10, 15 people. It's going to be more effective sometimes than what we can do at the larger level. What else? Appealing to your fundraiser's motivation. So, you know, fundraisers want to be successful first and foremost. If they are signing up to do this, like there's a little bit of like personal pride in there of so just saying, so we want to help you be successful. So we're going to offer support and tips. Keeping people focused on the basics is really important. So letting people know that like that is, you are here to help them be a successful fundraiser. Anything that they need. Reminding them why that fundraising is so important. So that's really appealing to, if they're really mission focused, if they are, you know, reminding them, here's what another, the every $500 you raise will help fund X. Those can be really great ways to do it. Some people are really motivated by competition. You can usually figure out who those are really quickly, right? So building a sense of competition among teams, you can do leaderboards in your communication and say, here's the top 10 teams, you know, where do you rank or whatever that looks like. Again, not everybody is motivated by that, but you'll know which ones are. And then creating a sense of urgency, you know, challenges and incentive prizes can still work really well. It's amazing what people will do for a free t-shirt, a free t-shirt when really they have to raise $100. But it is amazing what people will want to earn, especially if they're really tied to your camp, to your brand, and they're really proud to wear that baseball cap or carry that tote bag that has your logo on it. Those can be really great motivators. And then fundraising challenges. Sometimes you just need to spark that activity. You know, it's saying, can you, you know, how many emails can you send out in the next 24 hours? Or how many new team members can you recruit this week? You know, it gives them a way to focus. And all those small activities, again, it's kind of back to those micro influencers, I guess. The more you kind of spark that activity, it's just going to become exponential growth and they won't even realize that you're doing it. And lastly, I would say using your data. So I am a total data nerd and I own it, right? And I'm just checking my time. Oh, we still got plenty of time. Lots of times for questions. But using your data to drive your coaching conversations. So if you're going to pick up the phone and you're thinking, okay, what am I going to say to this person? Like, I want to make sure I'm saying the right thing. So if you look at that data, any platform is going to have reports that show this information. But so let's say a team has signed up, but maybe they really haven't got anybody signed up. It's like a team of two. They really haven't had more people. Well, then that becomes the topic of your conversation. Your focus on that team captain is, how can we grow your team? How can we help you recruit more people? Or if it's a company that has signed up and like, three people have signed up, right? Excuse me, I accidentally clicked too quickly. It's a great conversation to have. So instead of starting to talk to them about all these other pieces, you know, hone in on recruitment. Or maybe they've set a really high fundraising goal. A team has said, we want to raise $25,000 and they're at 400. They got a long way to go, right? So it's calling that team captain and saying, we're so excited you set this great goal. We're so grateful for your support. What do you need from us? How do we help you get there? Or they've recruited lots of people, but nobody's really fundraising. So you can look at a report and you see, oh, okay, well, they've got 35 people signed up and only 4 people have actually done anything to raise money. So again, that becomes that conversation to say, how do we motivate your fundraisers? You know, what can we do to get them excited? Can you offer an internal challenge? What can we do? So again, there's so much that you can pull from your data that will really, again, guide these conversations. So that's really the overview of it all. I feel like I talked really fast, a lot faster than I thought I was going to. So what other questions can I answer for some of you, or if I need to go back on anything and elaborate?
Feel free, anyone, you can, I'll keep an eye on the chat here if you want to ask a question in the chat or just unmute yourself and ask Marcy. But, you know, I think my biggest takeaway of hearing Marcy share, you know, sort of best practices and about peer-to-peer is that it's not just, hey, we're going to do this campaign and I'm going to send it out in a blast email and I'm going to just try to get, hopefully people will respond. Like, it takes a lot of work to steward and cultivate your peer-to-peer fundraisers, right? There are people that already believe in your mission, that love what you do. They're your camp volunteers. They're willing to go tell their story and to ask their friends. They love your camp so much that they're willing to ask their friends, their family, their coworkers outside of camp to support something that they truly love. So we have to do the work to steward them, to cultivate them, to coach them, to give them sort of the content to keep it exciting throughout a campaign or throughout an event or things like that. So it's not just that simple, like, hey, we're going to try to do this peer-to-peer thing and cross our fingers and hope it works. There's certainly a lot of work to do on our end, but I think some of the tips that Marcy shared will certainly help us do that and certainly helps us be better coaches in this area. So with that, does anybody have any questions? You were that good, Marcy.
Yara let me off really easy.
What we will do is we will share Marcy's contact info. So if anybody does have follow-up questions, you certainly can reach out to Marcy directly.
Great.
And Jennifer's going to pull up an exit poll, just so if everybody wants to fill that out before you sign off today. And again, I just encourage you, again, if you're thinking about peer-to-peer or you already do peer-to-peer, take away some of the things that Marcy shared today, but also join us at 3 p.m. Eastern time today. We have Camp Sunshine, Rapa Hope, and Camp Ronald McDonald for Good Times, who are all going to share their success with peer-to-peer. And like I said earlier, also share, you know, their challenges that they faced. When they started doing this, they had the same questions all of you probably have. So I think it will be a great opportunity to see what other camps are doing and don't reinvent the wheel. It's already there. It already exists. So get some good ideas from them. So once you fill out the exit poll, feel free to sign off. And again, we'll share Marcy's contact info with everyone after the session. So thank you, Marcy, so much.
Yeah, thank you all. Good luck with the rest of your academy.
Thank you, Marcy.